Hey, everybody, and welcome to a conversation about the Kentucky Goblins, of all things. I've got Rob from the most interesting story with me here again today. Last time we talked about dogmen or dog people, I don't know. We never did actually go down the path of gendering dogmen, but
we didn't figure out the pluralization either. So
I don't know about that. We should have looked up and seen what the Spanish and the French people had to say about it. But anyway, this time we're talking about the Kentucky Goblins, and as far as I know, they're totally asexual. But we may find out later.
Yeah,
how's it going, Rob?
It's going fantastic, Bob. Thanks for having me on again.
So, you know, this is a really interesting case that has multiple multiple names to it, right? So it's also called the Hopkinsville Encounter. It's also called the Kelly Green Men case because the family's last name was Kelly, who had the experience, right? So it goes by many names, and we're gonna talk about them as the Kentucky Goblins. Because it sounds like a sports team, possibly from your alma mater down there in Kentucky. I don't know.
That would be a good sports team.
Yeah. Now, there is a, I know because I had the new people who went to school there, but there's a place called Murray State in Kentucky. And it's in Murray, Kentucky, of all places. And but their mascot is the Racers. The horses, Murray Racers is what they were. I always thought that was one of the best sports college, you know, non-popular. I don't know what you'd call it. It's not like Big Ten or any of that kind of stuff. They're just a regular old school. But Murray Racers I thought was really good. So maybe there's a community college in Kentucky called the Goblins. We'll have to look that up.
Is Duke in Kentucky? I should know this. I think
Duke might be. Duke's North Carolina.
Yeah, I knew that. Right.
Mm-hmm. Sorry.
All right. I'm glad you do. I thought there was a there was maybe it's Kentucky. It's like the larger Kentucky University. Maybe that's what I'm thinking of.
Now, here in St. Louis, there is a private university called St. Louis University, and their mascot is the Billiken, which is a goblin-like creature.
Really?
Yeah, the Billikens. It's like a little gremlin, gobliny kind of weird looking thing.
Didn't he play for the Washington Redskins quarterback?
Could be. I'm not sure about that. But is his name Billiken?
I think so. Billiken, Billy Kilmore, something like that.
Oh, maybe. Well, Billikens are a big thing here in St. Louis with the St. Louis University. But they're not, you know, any kind of big university, you know, like, you know, other ones. I don't even know which one. I don't even follow college sports. I just follow mascots, apparently.
You got all the flags up and you just stare at the mascot.
That's right. There was a movie called Mascots. I have not watched it, but now I feel like I should after all this.
Well, you've got to check out Mascots Memories. It's one of the episodes on Your Most Interesting Story, which is actually an interview with a former professional sports team.
I actually listened to that.
There you go.
I have listened to that. He was
Sharky. San Jose the Sharks.
The Sharks. That's right. Yep. I was going to say something else. I'm glad I didn't know. But that was interesting because he came from the ceiling. He came down from the ceiling. That was just crazy.
Yeah, he's the one that figured that out and started doing that for Sharky, right?
Yeah, for sure. And he would eat people or what have you. Yeah,
he would eat their heads repeatedly. Yeah.
That was a good story. I really enjoyed that one. I'm sorry, I didn't remember he was with the Sharks off the top of my head.
Well, he was also with the 49ers before they had Sourdough Sam, so kind of the nameless mascot, I guess.
Yeah. He was just like a bucket. He was a pail. a panning. He was a gold pan. That was what he was. So what have you got for us, Rob, on the Kentucky Goblins case?
Kentucky Goblins. One correction, though. You'd mentioned that they were called the Kelly Goblins. That's because the other town that their farm was near was actually called Kelly. Hmm. So there's two towns, Hopkinsville and Kelly.
I thought their last name was Kelly for some reason. No,
there's two families involved, the Suttons and the Taylors. Those are the primary families that were involved.
Oh, there you go. Mm-hmm. Look at that. Mm-hmm. Go figure. Yeah. Okay.
So we can call them the Kelly Goblins, the Hopkinsville Goblins, the Kentucky Goblins. You can have a hob in there if you want to. We could call them Billikens if you want to keep on theme.
I think that we might get sued if we call them the Billikens, to be honest. It's a very wealthy university in St. Louis that is there. So
isn't there a Milliken? I don't know.
There is a Milliken university in Decatur where I'm from.
Is there a mascot, the Billikens?
Big Blue. I don't know that. I don't know what that refers to.
Maybe we don't want to know. Have you seen a picture of their mascot?
I don't remember. I lived there for quite a long time. I was grew up there and everything. And actually, my wife was going to that university when we met. But I don't remember what. I think it's just like a guy wearing blue, as far as I know.
Huh. Well, he's got the proper name then. If that's
yeah,
the
I'll have to look it up. He seemed big to me. But this is a private school. It's for more wealthy people than me.
They didn't spend a lot of time on the
mascot. I did actually. I spent time on campus there, even though I didn't go to school there, only because I was apparently looking for women.
It worked, right?
It worked. I mean, if. Just a piece of advice to any youngsters out there, go to one of the best schools in your area and hang out until you find somebody.
There you go. That's wise.
I mean, it can't hurt better than being at the, you know, welfare line or in the unemployment line, I suppose. I don't know.
Drop a line in the water and see if any bites.
Yeah. I mean, that's a whole other story. Maybe we don't want to go down that one, but we did, yeah. And I think it's just, they just were called Big Blue. Now you got me thinking I should look it up.
Because the Milliken Billikens would be a lot of fun to say over and over again.
I don't think, they definitely weren't the Billikens. Let's see what it says here.
Pelicans?
The Pelicans, no.
Billiken, no. He's a trademark name.
A private college in Decatur, which is weird in and of itself. Oh, okay. It's got this. He looks like a monster. He's called Big Blue. Mm. Now, this was definitely not the mascot whenever I was there.
Is he goblin-esque?
No, he's more like Bigfoot-esque.
Okay.
But he's on all fours. He looks very, kind of primate, ape-like. But he's got large teeth and red eyes.
Oh.
And it's called Big Blue.
There we go.
But that incarnation was definitely not around when I was. I would have remembered that and locked that into my head.
Yeah, you probably still have some clothing, some athletic wear.
Could be. Now, it looks like an older version of Big Blue was a bird-like creature. But now they've got the cooler.
Shapeshifter, maybe?
Yeah. Yeah. The Milliken Skinwalkers. No, it looks like they just changed it to make it look cooler than like a big bird. So he looked kind of like a bit of a diseased bluebird. But now he looks like a nice big monster, which is even better.
Maybe he was a diseased phoenix, and then he arose from the ashes and became
definitely what you described. Definitely not a phoenix. I mean, he literally looks like a Muppet reject in this picture. It's like Jim Henson probably said, who made this? They're fired, and threw the costume and the person right out the door.
And they probably got it on sale.
It could be. But I do love mascot. But yeah, the new one, the picture of the new one is definitely much. They didn't show a picture of like a person wearing a suit, but if they got a suit of this, this would be pretty good.
I'm glad to see that some areas of our country are making forward progress. That's fantastic.
Yeah, it's definitely very cryptid looking for sure. The bird looked very like not very good at all, but this new one definitely.
It's another step in the right direction.
Yeah, and they call him Big Blue. So I was right with at least the name, Big Blue. Yeah.
He might have been inspired by Bigfoot. Foot was taken, and so they went with Big Blue instead.
Mm-hmm. Could be. Could be. I'll have to. This may be a whole nother show. We probably should get back to goblins.
We should get back to the Kentucky, Kelly, and or Hopkinsville goblins.
And you you know, I read through some stuff, and I swear that Kelly was the last name of the family. So I've already been corrected. Apparently, I'm the dumb guy in this duo for this topic right here.
Well, and I'm relying, as mentioned in previous episodes, on AI. So, there, you know, the hallucination that AI does. So perhaps they've screwed something up and all my sources are just giving me the wrong information. But I think I've heard it in a couple of different places. So
I pulled up the wiki, which, of course, is, you know, solid as a rock. Uh-huh. And they do say Sutton and Taylor are the two names of the families. There, so.
Yep.
Yeah.
So the whole thing starts because Billy Ray Taylor, who is apparently a family friend, I think, of the Suttons.
Mm-hmm. He sees, I guess so. Yeah, Billy Ray, yeah.
He sees a silvery object shooting through the sky on the Suttons while he's at the Suttons farm.
Mm.
I think that's how the whole thing starts, the story more or less. And then he goes back to the farmhouse, right? And the Suttons are there, including Lucky. Lucky's one of the Suttons.
And that's a very good name.
It is a very good name.
This is like the pre-traveling Wilburys, I think.
Lucky and Billy Ray.
Right. There was a new Lucky in the recent incarnation in the late 80s, but yeah.
Apparently, Billy Ray's a bit of a, no one believed him, right? Maybe a jokester of sorts, but they soon came to believe him, right? Because pretty soon their little farmhouse was what appeared to be under attack, is probably a strong word.
Mm-hmm.
But they were being approached by some interesting looking creatures. What is your information? How are they described in the information that you've?
Well, they have a drawing here, and they look like, they don't look like anything that you would. I'm trying to. They look kind of like gremlins. Like if you were to think about a gremlin, gremlins have like bigger ears, right?
Yep.
And a big head, you can't really tell this. The stature, they show a comparison. They're about half the size of an average person, so about 2.5 feet. 2.5 to 3 feet tall, and their arms are really long. They hang down arms, all the way down to their ankles almost in this picture.
Some have called their arms emaciated. It's kind of
real. Yeah, and they're real thin. Yeah, mm-hmm. And their eyeballs though are on the sides of their head almost.
Glowing gold eyeballs.
Yeah, but then their bodies are, I guess, somewhat proportional to their diminutive stature, other than their really long legs and their weird ass head.
The big pointy ears, yeah.
Yeah, the pointy ears.
Totally normal outside of that.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah, totally. Yeah, exactly. Could be possibly a child with, some kind of large tubes on his arms and wearing a bucket.
Right, paper towel tubes, perhaps. Really thin arms.
You know how just run around and, yeah.
Remember the old days, the Christmas wrapping tubes? They were a little bigger. You could actually fit your arm in them.
Yeah, the old ones you could, and then you could be like a robot. And, well, we used to beat each other with them. The fun part was to get to the tube, and then your mom would give it to you or whatever. And then you would stick it on your hand like a weapon, and then you would run around and hit everybody.
Or you stick behind them and kind of go through the tube in their ear.
Yeah. Yeah, that's good too.
Oh, those were the days when the tubes were large.
Well, I'll tell you, I had I can't remember when it was. I'm not very good at wrapping things, but I will give it a try. And I think my wife was wrapping, though, actually, presents for our kids. And she got to the end, and I was so hoping to get the tube.
Oh.
You know what? No tube.
Is it just that sort of that rounded off piece of, brown paper, kind of the stiff paper, no tube at all?
Yeah, no tube at all. I was like, this is tubeless. Why in the world do they even bother? I mean, it has no life other than being wrapping paper, which in a sense, it has no life. It's basically made to be ripped up and thrown away.
Yeah. It does make some animals happy. At least one animal. And I knew a family who had a husky dog. Mm-hmm. And when they were done unwrapping gifts, they would give the wrapping paper to the dog, who would just shred it. He would go nuts. He loved doing it so much.
So he ripped it even more.
Even more. He just would tear it totally apart. Yeah.
Unfortunately, that wrapping paper also got to travel through the digestive tract of a husky.
I'm not sure they let him eat too much of it, but they'd have to clean that up afterwards.
Something went through. Whenever you...
Maybe the first time or two, right, before they started watching so closely.
So extra usage there.
Mm-hmm. But they're very long, spindly arms, right? In fact, speaking of arms, and this is where I hesitated to say that the farmhouse was under attack, is because the first, at least the visual that stuck out to me, what they described from the witnesses who were supposedly there, was one of the creatures comes walking from the wood line with their arms raised up over their head. Mm. Right. And some say, well, maybe they were just trying to say, hey, we're not trying to cause any trouble here. We're just here to come have a conversation. They pulled out the guns, right? They pulled out the shotguns and rifles, and they were having none of it. They started firing at these creatures.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think they used to call that the Kentucky hello.
Kentucky hello. That's right. They probably walked right past the no trespassing sign at the end of the driveway.
you come walking out of the woods looking like a gremlin, you're going to get the Kentucky hello. Now we said the date. So I have August 21st, 1955, which I think is interesting.
Because
it's so long ago now. Oh. And this is this is not something that happened yesterday, and it's
still talked about to this day.
Still talked about to this day, but also it's the time period, you know, everything now is divided into, you know, pre-internet, pre-social media. Right. Mm-hmm. So you can't look at this case the same as the Las Vegas case that just happened a less than a year ago or so, where the people said this thing landed in their backyard and these things were running around, because that's after the internet and after social media. And so, because everybody's, even us, the reason we're talking about the Kentucky Goblins is because, you know, we want somebody to listen to it.
Mm-hmm.
These people in 55, who are they spoofing? Who are they, you know, what's the deal?
Well, Lucky was a bit of a jokester, but no, I don't think they would have invented a story quite like this if they wanted to. I don't know. That's actually one of the debunking theories as we get to the end of this and the end of the timeline. Some people say, well, they just did it to try to get some attention or make some extra money, but I don't buy that. I think this is another one of the situations. This isn't unlike the Mothman scenario, mm-hmm. where there's no real reason for the folks involved to, as you are implying, you know, go out and communicate widely about this, because all they've got is downside for the most part.
Right, exactly. That's the thing. It's all downside. I mean, I don't know that in Hopkinsville in 1955 there was easy monetization for little green men, but I'm pretty sure there wasn't. It makes you wonder. I mean, that. And they had the sheriff come out. They had all kinds of people come out.
The sheriff did come out. And there's a couple of folks in law enforcement who actually testified about the believability of the witnesses based on some of the things that they saw when they came into the police station. But it's interesting when you mentioned their little green creatures. One of the details about this, when I did my extensive pre-episode research, Bob, was the fact that they're silver. They're described as silvery, as opposed to green. Mm. So green was kind of assigned to them a little bit afterwards, you know, that telephone game where people talk about it one-to-one. But they were actually silvery colored, according to the folks who were there at the farmhouse.
Really? Okay. Now that's a detail that I did not pick up, other than the fact that I got the name wrong. A detail I didn't pick up.
That's why I'm here. That's why I do the extensive research that I do.
That's good.
But I think the matriarch of the Sutton family, Glennie, I believe was her name. She described them as a gas can with a small head on top and long arms and skinny legs or something like that. So silvery creatures. So I know the sketch that you're probably looking at, because I saw that around a lot on the internet. I think we sort of maybe made it a little bit more, I won't say humanoid because they're not really humanoid, but more animal-like maybe than they would have described it.
I'm thinking of the gas can, that the old style gas cans from that time period were kind of a cylinder, right, with a bottom.
Yeah, the rounded rounded top.
And then the top was, it's not like the plastic ones we have now. These all at the time were metal, and they usually were cylindrical with something slapped on the top and bottom.
Yep.
Yeah.
And that's making me think that, and especially when you hear some of the details about how the shotguns, the bullets apparently did not have effect on them. One of the descriptions was when they shot one of them, it kind of pinballed backwards and spun around, but was not actually harmed. Mm-hmm. So part of me thinks, if we're going to go into this and into the idea of thinking back to the silvery object that streaked across the sky that Billy Ray saw, like if these are some sort of a space suit that the folks, if they did come out of that supposed potential crashing craft, are wearing, and we don't even know what they look like when they take their outfits off.
Or, and this is a possibility, they are robots.
You know, the more as AI advances and we start getting closer to actually having robots that can function and do things, if you were going to explore new worlds, wouldn't you send a robot as opposed to going on your own?
Yeah, and the silvery nature, obviously metallic nature, the long arms make it easy for it to maneuver, right?
They could take a piece of fruit. They could reach down to the ground swiftly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if we look at, there's a I'm a butcher the name, but Pascagoula, Mississippi abduction case with those two guys in the early 70s who were fishing and got abducted.
Okay,
they thought their visitors were not human, they were robots.
There's a theory out there that the grays, the classic gray aliens, are actually robots, some sort of a non-physical entity.
Now that I don't, and then that would also explain the whole can't shoot them. I mean, they could easily be made of titanium or some other element that we're not as familiar with and be bulletproof.
I said non-physical entity. I meant non-organic, I guess.
Non-organic,
right. But yeah, exactly. That does explain a lot. Perhaps why their eyes are glowing, right? They got some sort of battery power, because my eyes don't glow.
Well, I would assume not. Never know.
Sometimes it'd be handy.
Maybe in your youth,
I had a shiny coat and glowing eyes.
but again, you talk about these poor people, and they had a gunfight with these creatures or robots or whatever. And in 1955, even today, you know, even though we are a gun society in the United States, I would say still, you're not going to just start using all this ammunition for no reason. I mean, it costs money, and it costs money back then. It costs money now. From what I could glean from my, rather cursory examination of everything, is these people didn't necessarily want to just keep throwing money into the woods.
No, they did not. They were not necessarily a wealthy family.
Yeah,
based on my information as well. And then you say gun battle. I'm gonna defend the little creatures a little bit. They didn't. They seemed like maybe they just had wanted to come in. Maybe they had to use the bathroom.
That's true. They didn't shoot back at them, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
It was one-sided gun battle.
Now they certainly didn't get the hint. Right, they kept coming when they were firing at them.
Well, if they've explored other planets, potentially they've been shot at many times.
Right. Well, though, yeah, this is right. This could be part of when they do their training. When you first arrive, more than likely the residents are going to have some sort of ammunition fire,
or they get things thrown at you. I mean, maybe they mostly have encountered monkeys,
and
they just assumed it was poop.
Poop or small rocks.
Yeah.
Yep.
Exactly.
They've got an interesting way to fire their poop. They're probably, that's what's going through the robot heads.
The robots are going, this poop is really traveling.
They've got specialized weaponry to fire poop at us.
This is the velocity of this poop is much greater than the last
people. They're taking all these readings, right? They're just, all this stuff's going back to the mothership. A very interesting perspective of the human race at that point in time, back in 1955.
These must be a bunch of metal eaters because this poop is rock hard.
It's got a smell of gunpowder. What are they eating?
I mean, you have to. We always, because we're so, what do you want to call it? Maybe conceited, is that the word? We assume, you know, like he raised his hands as if he came in peace. Like he would even, these things would even know what that means. We assume all these, it's almost like me as a cartoon cat. Everybody puts all these things on the cartoon cat like it's a real person, right? So we're doing the same thing. And there's a word for that, which you might know, Rob, but I don't know. Off the top of my head here, but
anthropomorphizing or something.
There we go. We're anthropomorphic. Yeah, anthropomorphic. Nice. Yeah, the creatures to think that they have any clue how to do anything in our society, like put up their hands or, you know, I don't know. Well, they jumped on top of the house, but maybe that's how they enter their houses. We don't know.
They're trying. They think the chimney is the door,
right?
So they're trying to get in. And the people, in fact, one of them reached down and grabbed someone by the hat or hair. That was one of the details. Someone went out on the porch and there was one up on the roof. Another interesting detail that I heard in my sources is that they didn't necessarily see more than one or two of these at any given time. But yet it felt like there was a lot of them out there. So perhaps these things were just really swiftly moving to give the impression of many. Maybe it's just a couple. Maybe it's a couple of robots.
Right. Well, if they're robots, maybe they can move a lot faster. Or teleportation abilities, perhaps, or you know, some other type of technology that allows them to move a lot faster than humans can. Well, apparently, except for putting their hands down the chimney or whatever, but.
Maybe their arms are retractable, and maybe they extend. Remember the robot from Lost in Space?
Right. Yeah, he was probably The other problem, he didn't have any legs, and so they had always had to be in a flat surface.
That's true.
I don't know if they sent down a bulldozer ahead of time to keep it so that he could move around, but you know.
They kept them close to the ship because if the ship could land, they just keep the robot near the ship.
Danger. But yeah, these guys seem much more maneuverable with their long arms and short legs.
Well,
and
advanced, right?
Big noggins. Yeah.
If we were to build the Lost in Space, I bet you if they did a new movie with Lost in Space, that the robot would be a lot more mobile.
Oh, they did. It was on Netflix a few years ago. And he was much more maneuverable. Yeah. The one from the original show was very clunky.
Yeah, kind of a bumbling. We happened to watch an episode of that, which I don't recommend because it was not nearly as good as I recall it being as a kid.
Just the music.
And I told my kid before, because they'd never heard it. I'm like, hey, check out this theme song. You're really going to like this. And I'm like, no, it's not that good either. And so it was generally very disappointing. But not how I remembered it back in the day.
But Will Robinson's still doing the circuits because he was still fairly young, comparatively speaking. Because he was such a kid.
He was definitely I know he was on the Dating Game at some point, but I think did he have like a major role in some ongoing show? I'm trying to remember.
Not that I'm aware of. I he was in bands. I know he was played in several bands.
Bill Mooney, right?
Yeah, Bill Mooney. Yeah, he was in several bands over time, and obviously he was always doing the nostalgia circuit for Lost in Space, and making cameos for everybody who remembered him. Mm-hmm. I personally, from what I recall, I mean, he seemed like a really nice person in all these interactions that they portray. So. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he really is, but I'm assuming it. So,
well, you can only assume what you have experienced, right? I'm a fan of that. Don't You can have an idea, but let the actual actions speak for themselves.
Yeah. Now, as Don West, who played the other...
Adam West.
No, Don West.
Okay, he was going to Batman.
He was a total jerk.
Was he?
I'm just joking. I have no idea. I think he died fairly young, so...
But let that be a lesson for anyone listening out
Plus,
there.
Plus, no one remembers who he was, Don West, so that's why I said that.
No, I was confusing him with Adam West.
And yeah. Another West, yeah.
Now, that show does not disappoint. We do watch episodes of Batman again, and those go to their villain.
That has good music, too. Dun, it da, does. Dun, 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 dun. Yeah, yep. Exactly. Yeah. Yep.
Sorry. And there are sort of like cryptid-esque characters, right? The penguin and the people sort of like not typical humanoid penguins, right?
Yeah.
So I guess there's a bit of a cryptid.
Egghead,
connection.
Right?
Oh, Egghead, yeah.
The King Tut guy.
Mm-hmm. So they're firing at these creatures, and they make a run for it. They're so freaked out. I think it's calm. I'm going to assume it's calm for a while. They run out to their pickup trucks. Bob, they've got pickup trucks. I made sure I knew what kind of vehicle that they were.
Of course they did.
Yeah,
everybody has.
Well, yes, that's true. They're on a farm, and they go scooting off to the police department in Hopkinsville, in the police station in Hopkinsville. Mm-hmm. And they say, "This is what's going on," and they're all freaked out. And the police say, "Well, we better get back there and see what the heck's going on."
Mm-hmm.
So about a half hour, 45 minutes later, the police arrive. There's military police from Fort Campbell nearby. And a photographer arrives at the Sutton farmhouse to investigate. But the only evidence remaining, despite what the witnesses are saying, are the actual shotgun shells.
Mm-hmm.
Everything else appears to be gone, with one exception. Well, I shouldn't say one, but an exception that stuck out to me is some of the folks that were there the first time, they saw some sort of a, what they call it, like a mark or an indentation or a... I wrote this down. I forgot the word that they used, but essentially it looked like something was in the grass that could only be seen. It kind of appeared to shimmer at a certain angle from a distance. Like there's a shimmeriness to this substance that was on the ground. But when they got close to it, I guess the shimmeriness sort of went away. And then later on, we'll hear they actually came back the following day, and that was then gone as well. So is that maybe where, I don't know, maybe they jumped out of the spaceship and landed there and left a little robot slime on the ground that dried up?
I was going to say he took a leak.
He could have. Right. So there goes my theory about them having to use the bathroom. But yeah, it could be goblin pee.
Yeah. He'd be like, I'll be right with you guys. I'm right behind you. He's standing there relieving himself, and then pew, 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 pew. Oh my God, what's going on?
But he should be using his hands. I mean, that's my. I mean, I don't know where he. Well, comes from. He shouldn't have his hands over his head. I don't.
Yeah. Well, maybe he didn't have any Purell.
Oh, that could be it too, right? You wanted to say, yeah. You got to go back in the spaceship.
Oh, I gotta go. I gotta get these cleaned up before I touch anything else.
Otherwise, my buddy over there is gonna complain. So I'm gonna show that my hands are clear of this situation. You know what? I forgot to let you know about. We got another quiz for you here about the goblins.
Oh, sure.
You want to go through the quiz?
Oh, sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry. I clicked the wrong button there. Go ahead.
I'll look right ahead. So they start easy, and we've covered some of these. So this is going to be a test of your memory.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we kind of riffed the lunch there.
We did. I forgot that I had the quiz all queued up for you. But the year, what's the year? You've already said this. We know.
1955, yeah.
Exactly. Now, this one you wouldn't have gotten without me doing a little bit of the info correctedness over here. But between which two Kentucky towns was the Sutton Farm located?
Well, you corrected me. You said Hopkinsville and Kelly. So
exactly.
But yeah, exactly. I wouldn't have got that. I knew Hopkinsville, but I wouldn't have got the other one.
This we just talked about. What town did they flee to seek help from law enforcement?
Hopkinsville.
Exactly. And what type of firearms did the residents use to attempt to defend themselves from the creatures?
Well, you said shotguns.
They also apparently use rifles too.
Oh, okay.
Not a big gun guy, but I guess
will be a different shell. That's for sure.
Right. Isn't a shotgun a rifle or is it?
No. Shotguns, well, no, I would say people would say a shotgun is not a rifle. That would be my determination. Because
you use shot instead of a bullet.
Right. Something. Exactly. You're using, although you can use a slug in a shotgun for certain things, but a shotgun generally is a larger barrel diameter.
Okay.
And it can usually it has shot rather than having one lead bullet. So,
okay.
Yeah. So, yeah. But I think that's the only difference. But you think of it as a long barrel, then you think of a rifle as opposed to a short barrel. But I know there are pistol style shotguns.
Are there? Now, there are double barrel shotguns. I've heard that. Are there double barrel rifles?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. You can have a double barrel rifle. So but now those are less common.
Teaching me things.
Well, I'm not a big gun guy either. I happen to grow up in an area where it's prevalent.
A lot of shotguns.
A lot of everything. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Everything. I probably had the pleasure of shooting them. I don't know. Over time, it's not been my hobby, but you know, when somebody's shooting a gun and you're there, you're like, hey, can I shoot that gun? Sure.
Yeah, I can see the draw of that for sure. Yeah.
I mean, you're there, you might as well.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
We want to talk about micro tears in your brain from shooting guns, then that's probably, I didn't know about that till recently. So
so is that from like having it close to your face when it goes off and it's sort of like the recoil or
right. That? So the percussion of depending on what you're shooting, right? How big of the char, how many grains of gunpowder and so forth are in the shell and everything. There are the percussion of it. If you do it enough, you can actually jiggle your brain enough to hurt it by shooting a gun.
Huh.
And that I think that's been proven at this point. I don't think that's it was a myth for a while, and I think now it's been proven. So, because you're especially with the recoil of a rifle or a shotgun or what have you, or God forbid, you're in the military, you're shooting machine guns and whatnot,
right.
Then that back and forth motion, and then also just the you're breaking the sound barrier, right?
Yeah,
right by your head,
right by your, mm-hmm.
And all that going through your body.
So wait, is that part of the gun sound? Is the breaking of the sound barrier from the gun?
It's from the hammer striking the primer that sets the gunpowder igniting to shooting the bullet out or the shot. It's a whole complicated thing going on there, Rob.
It's a bit of, that's a very, we could talk for another episode about how guns fire probably.
So if you've ever seen, if you ever look at if you look at those shotgun shells that they had there in Kentucky, they're round. And then if you notice, there's a little round thing in the middle of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the primer. And the primer is what's going to, when the hammer strikes that, it's going to have a chemical reaction that's going to ignite the gunpowder inside that shell. And then that explodes, and the easiest way out is the barrel. So everything goes out the end of the barrel. But every action has an equal and opposite reaction. So whereas some of that goes back on you, right, into your shoulder, into your, and then the sound of it, because it is breaking the sound barrier. So it's traveling so fast out that, then you get that crack, and that sound wave goes through you as well.
I have very sensitive ears, or I did as a kid. I used to cry at fire engines.
Really?
Yeah, so loud. We would go to the local town fair where I grew up in West Virginia, and then when the fire truck came by, if they had their siren on, it would set me to crying. Too loud.
I'm sorry, Rob.
Well, I've gotten over it, and my hearing is going bad, so it's actually nice. I have now typical mortal hearing. I don't have super.
Well, that's good.
Yeah,
I'm glad that that society had brought you down to normal.
Yes, I've normalized.
That the psyop of fire engines has brought you down.
Okay, we're in the medium difficulty on your quiz. Are you ready?
I'm ready. Okay. I'm ready.
Now this is going to require a little bit of recall as well. But what was the last name of the family who lived in the farmhouse?
Taylor. I would say it was Taylor.
No, those were the Suttons that lived
there. Oh, the Suttons. I knew Taylor it was Sutton or Taylor.
God. Yep. Yep. Yeah. The Taylors were visiting. It was Billy
Shot
Ray.
Too many guns.
And his wife. I don't have the name of Billy Ray's wife, but she was there too, although she didn't come up in the stories that I heard.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You know about this one already. What did Billy Ray initially see in the sky before the creatures appeared?
He saw like some kind of light or arc in the sky. Some kind of silver thing. Yeah,
silvery, round metallic object.
Yeah.
Streaking across the sky.
Sputnik. Sputnik was coming down.
It could have been Sputnik. Who saw the creatures? And this is okay. Now we're heading into new territory and we're in the medium difficulty section. Who saw the creatures once again after the investigators left that first night?
I don't know, but I'm going to say Lucky.
No, it was not someone lucky. Else you've heard about. Glennie, the matriarch of the family.
Yep. Well, see, now that doesn't jive with them. I mean, unless Glennie's in on it, then Lucky is not going to get Glennie to say, yeah, I saw him again.
I don't think so. And it was at her bedroom window screen with its claw-like hand.
That's
what Glennie saw, yeah. Now, let's head back to the timeline here a little bit. And then, because we'll move on to the next question after we go. Get the timeline figured out. But after the investigators, they all come, they only find the shotgun shells, they leave. And the next day they come back and that's when they only find the substance was no longer on the ground, that shimmery substance. I just learned some of this data yesterday and I'm reading through the bullet points. I'm rapidly trying to find my timeline on my computer screen and now I've got it in front of me again. Okay. Was it smooth? Could you tell that I was searching frantically for something?
No, I didn't.
It didn't sound very smooth to me. The investigators leave. Then Glennie sees the creature at her bedroom window. And the police continue with their investigation and they interview witnesses and neighbors, but no further evidence are found. So that's essentially where things sort of wrap up outside of the media attention in terms of the actual incident. Like there's nothing about them officially departing except for the last time that Glennie saw them later that night. So now we can head back to the quiz because we have not covered any important points. This is specific to, and again, I'm looking for a document. Can you tell that I'm searching this time? So obviously a lot of people don't believe their story. How dare they?
Right, yeah.
But there is a specific type of bird that folks who are attempt to debunk this, actually one paranormal investigator as well who looked into this, claimed that this specific type of bird was responsible for what the witnesses experienced. Do you know what that bird was?
They probably said it was an owl, is my guess.
It was. What type of owl? Do you have any? I mean, I think you get credit for this question. But
A barred owl, something like
great,
that?
Great horned owl.
A great horned owl. Okay, I was just going for a common owl. So,
yeah, whereas now if we're going to try to debunk the debunkers. They say, well, owls are not nearly as tall as they say the creatures were. The creatures, according to the witnesses, were over 3 feet tall.
Yeah.
In addition, the eyes of owls tend to not glow.
Unless you shine a light into them, and then they'll glow.
I guess that's true, yeah. Which they were not doing, as far as I know. Mm-hmm. And nor do owls rattle when shot at, generally.
Right. And they don't have arms.
They do not have long, emaciated arms.
Or look silvery. I mean, unless somebody went out and dressed up a bunch of owls in silver suits, I don't know why you would do that, but...
No, they probably have a lot of time on their hands. Yeah. Especially back then in 55 without the internet.
Have you ever been close to an owl? I don't think they really want to put on a silver suit.
I'm a fan of owls. I've not been close to one. I have seen close up pictures and videos of owls, but they do not look like they've got a bit of an attitude to them, based on what I could tell just from their facial expression.
They don't like to be messed with.
Yeah.
As far as I can tell, you don't go petting no owl. That's what I say.
I tend not to mess with anybody who can turn their head almost in a full circle.
Spit up bones.
That's one of my rules of thumb. So yeah, I won't mess with any owls.
You know, owls make pellets because they don't digest the bones, and they spit them back up in these little pellet looking things.
Do they spit them up, or do they pass them through the other end?
No, I believe they kind of choke them back out. Yeah.
Like a hairball?
Like a hairball. Yeah.
Bone ball? A bone ball.
A bone ball. Exactly. Yeah, because if it went through your digestion system, I would assume that some of it would dissolve. And so I do believe they kind of cough them back up.
Cough up a bone ball. That's where the expression cough up a bone ball comes from, probably.
I've never heard that.
Oh, that must be a California thing.
Never heard that one. Sorry.
So I did the last of the medium difficulty questions. How did the families... I suppose this would just be the families of the Suttons, because they're the permanent residents of the farmhouse, try to deter the crowds of curious visitors who showed up after the incident.
I'm assuming they shot at them, like they shot at the
things. They did not give them the Kentucky welcome. This is getting back to some of our early theories. They apparently had to install the no trespassing signs.
Oh.
But then they also tried, and this kind of backfired on them because it caused some of the debunking to flare up. They started charging admission because folks were just sort of tromping through their property, taking pictures because they heard about the story, and they're driving up on the driveway, and they probably don't even have pickup trucks, and they're driving up on their farm,
farm
driveway.
All
these city people coming out, taking pictures. I mean, back then they had the flash bulbs that made that big flash and the boosh sound, right?
Do they have That'd be annoying.
It really would. All times of day, people coming in to tromp around your farmhouse looking for signs of silvery goblins.
Yeah. I would agree.
So this is actually something, this was going to be a hard question, but now it might be easy because we've covered this a little bit. But what was interesting about the substance the police found in the grass on the farm when they went out to investigate?
Well, you said it was shimmery.
Yeah, it had a sheen to it when viewed from a specific angle.
Well, that gasoline has a sheen to it when...
Oh, yeah. Well, that might do it, yeah.
If you look...
like gas cans.
Right. And then, like, so, like, if you... Especially if you go down... Like, if you've ever been on a lake or gone fishing on a boat or whatever, up by the dock, you always see that sheen on the water because they're spilling, you know, gas and oil and whatnot in the water. And so it really has a weird iridescent look to it, but not at every angle. So I think that could be an explanation there. Maybe they peed gasoline.
Well, if they've got bodies shaped like gas cans, I think I think that they could just be anthropomorphized gas cans.
Yeah. Yeah, there was like a video game called Cuphead, if you remember.
Oh,
that. Gas can head.
Gas can body.
Yeah, whatever.
Body. Mm-hmm. I think Cuphead's probably a little more.
It rolls off the tongue. Better,
it does. Yeah. It does. Okay, so we're down to the last question. This is the hardest, and we have not covered this yet. So if you get this right, you win the quiz.
Okay. All or nothing.
All or nothing. Besides owls, what is another theory presented in the sources to explain what the family saw? In the sources, okay, that was my documents. But what other theory was presented by folks who have sort of looked at the evidence after the fact to say, this is what the family likely saw?
Oh, boy. Besides an owl, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Monkeys?
You won the quiz. Apparently, there was some traveling circus that broke down.
That's always the case. Circus.
You know, back in those days, the circus transportation vehicles were not as reliable as they are today, and so they were always breaking down. And apparently, some escaped monkeys from a traveling circus was one of the theories as to what Glennie, Billy Ray, and Lucky all saw that night.
It's always the monkeys, isn't it? They always blame the monkeys.
They did not mention whether the monkeys were ever dressed in silver suits.
Much easier to dress a monkey in a silver suit than an owl, I would say.
That's where that expression comes from.
Well, they did it for Lancelot Link, so I'm assuming they could do it for a circus.
Yeah, I would. Anybody listening, do not go back and look up episodes of Lancelot Link. You're talking about Lost in Space being a waste of time.
Lance Link, secret gym.
Yeah, that didn't even spark my interest as a kid. You like that one?
Oh yeah, come on. Who doesn't love monkeys dancing around?
I guess I gravitated towards sort of superhero type characters, and Lance Link wasn't doing it for me.
I remember we had, this wasn't mine, I'm sure, because Lance Link is a little before my time, just a bit, but we had a Lance Link comic books.
Oh.
Yeah. I had this. Big collection of comic books that were basically hand-me-downs from a lot of older relatives. Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of them was, there's a couple of Lancelot Link in there.
Wow.
I remember the song more than I remember anything, because that was a great song. The Lance Link Secret Chimp was the name of the show, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there was they had a band on there called The Missing Link. I believe it was the name of the band.
Yeah.
And they were, you know, monkeys. Dressed up monkeys.
Now, that was a good TV show. You should go back and watch The Monkeys. Now, The Monkeys Who Are Not Monkeys. That was a good
one. I watched all those as well. But
highly recommend.
They have a good song also.
A couple of them.
Yeah. Like, and believe it or not, this is a little bit, and you may know this. Let me see if you do. There was a counterculture. Actually, there was more than one counterculture person on the Monkees as a guest. Ooh. Involved with the Monkees. It may not be enough information for you.
Yeah. I need more of a hint.
He had a band called The Mothers of Invention.
Frank Zappa
was on the Monkees show.
I did not know that.
Yeah, go back and watch the later shows just before their cancellation. And there's an interview where Frank Zappa is playing Mike Nesmith, and Mike Nesmith is playing Frank Zappa.
I saw Frank Zappa in some, who sent me that clip? Frank Zappa was actually doing like real acting and something. Did he branch into actual acting? It was some sort of,
maybe.
Like, I didn't watch Miami Vice. I want to say it was like a Miami Vice.
Yes, he was in Miami Vice. Okay. I did see that. Yes,
there
he was.
Go.
Yeah.
There we go.
Frank Zappa is. I mean, I don't know if he probably wouldn't consider himself counterculture, but yeah, people probably know him as a counterculture type person. Yeah.
What's the name of Zappa music?
And the opening act for the Monkees at one point, very early on, was Jimi Hendrix.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily peg that same musical style for the... If I'd gone there to see the Monkees and I wound up hearing Jimi Hendrix, so I'm not quite sure I would have... Hendrix. Yeah,
they were buddies.
That's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. Good trivia. Good knowledge. They have a totally off-roading on this topic. They came out with a Monkees album about 5 years ago. Really good. Mm-hmm. I definitely checking out. They had a lot of modern day songwriters sort of that wrote the songs for the Monkees, and they were performed by the remaining members. I think almost every, I think the I think Peter's the one that passed away.
Davey passed away first. Yeah.
I think maybe one song was able to have his vocals that they had sort of reconstituted from some other recording, but the rest of the band performed the rest of it. But highly recommended album.
I don't know why I would know this, but it was Davey, Peter, Mike, and now Mickey's still alive.
Mickey's the remaining monkey.
Yeah. Of all the monkeys to stay alive.
Who would have thought?
Who would have thought it would be Mickey?
I would have begged him.
Mickey, another side here, is part of the Hollywood vampires. Did you know that?
I did not.
He's a Hollywood vampire. You go look up Hollywood vampires.
Okay.
Originally, it was Harry Nilsson, Alice Cooper, John Lennon, and Mickey Dolenz.
All right.
They met every week to, they were all alcoholics and they met to get drunk at a club.
Okay.
And those four people, and then it snowballed, and now Johnny Depp is a Hollywood vampire because there is a group called the Hollywood Vampires who play, which is part of Alice Cooper and Johnny Depp and some other folks who still play rock and roll.
Nice.
Oh my gosh, we're spinning everywhere. Thank you. Covered. Is there anything else on the Kentucky Goblins here before we finish up?
Well, the last is there's a brief blip. It's not a network Netflix series, but Hellier. Right, Hellier, mm-hmm. And Bob, I think we've talked about this briefly, but there was some individual, he was a doctor, he was located in Kentucky, and apparently he sent some sort of semi-mysterious emails to a paranormal investigator implying that he believed his house was under siege by some sort of goblin-like creature.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's actually kind of an interesting series, but... The net of it is it was similar enough and the location was close enough to the original 1955 Kentucky Goblin story that some speculated that perhaps these silver skin diminutive skinny arm creatures crash landed on Earth and took up residence in some of the local caves in Kentucky and resurfaced, you know, what is this, 20 years ago now ish, mm-hmm. and started trying to prank this one doctor and his family.
Yeah, those crazy, you know, alien pranksters.
Well, if you're living underground for what, that'd be like 40, maybe 50 years. I mean, you're going to get a little bit stir crazy, I'm guessing. A little bit,
maybe.
They got to go out and see the light of day and let their you know, extended ears, their long pointed ears sort of see the light of day once in a while.
Right.
But there's a lot of caverns and caves down under Kentucky.
Yeah.
That's part of it.
Was it Bellwitch? It's in Kentucky. It's a cave.
Okay. And then Mammoth, is Mammoth Caverns, Mammoth Caves?
I think so. I think that's part of Kentucky.
There's some famous. When I lived in West Virginia, I know we went down there to see the cave once.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, cool. Well, I think we've solved this.
We figured it out.
The Kentucky Goblins.
Kentucky Goblins. All
done. Thanks, Rob. And make sure you go check out Rob's show at YouTube at YMIS Podcast, Your Most Interesting Story. And we'll be back again. And who knows? Maybe we'll talk more about the monkeys or maybe we'll talk more about mascots. Who knows? Thanks, Rob.
Thank you. Goodbye, everybody.
Till next time.